I was thinking of starting at the origin. So things started in kind of building this application framework. And this application framework, we leaned on something akin to what we had built at Google, which is a platform called Boq, B-O-Q, where it tackles how you write services, how do services talk with each other, how do you build services, how you test services, how you deploy services, how you observe services in production. This is actually how you build Namespace. Namespace is a collection of many, many services. And this is just an example of a test where we're writing a test that tests this server under test, which is a Postgres. And the test runner is written in Go. And you see here, so it's actually just something that it's just like a regular client. So in this case, it's a gRPC client that connects to an endpoint that is given to it, and then it just issues gRPC requests. And that's how we write tests. A test is just using the regular interface that backend offers. And in Foundation, you can define these, and if we go to test.server Postgres, so it's a little bit of code gen, you see that it's a Postgres demo server, and it imports a service, test data list. And here we go. This is, this service depends on Postgres, and it instantiates a database, and it exports a gRPC service called list service. So it's just a curiosity that, we have this graph of dependencies that go across code and then also orchestration. And that's the genesis. Like, we wanted to run these tests. So if we go back here, so that's internal test data test Postgres. So I run ns test, internal test data. Okay. And when you run ns test, you see that it's actually building something. It's building some software that is going to be used to prepare the database, and then after that it will now it's building the actual demo server, so that's the dependency, and now it's computing a deployment, and now it's deploying to a Kubernetes cluster that is running in my machine. Mm-hmm. So it deployed this Postgres server, it's compiling something else, which is an orchestrator that is deployed into the Kubernetes cluster to help ensure sequencing. So understand when a deployment is complete, and so it does kind of provides additional signaling. And after that is done, which should be very soon.
This output, what CLI is it? Like, what do you use, a library? What exactly is it? I haven't seen this before.
Yeah, this is us. This is Foundation. Foundation has this CLI.
Okay. Yeah. And what do you use in terms of library? Charm or something like that?
It was custom built.
Okay. Wow.
We have a sense of tasks. You can see here some coloring, which we were not too happy with it, but basically was trying to kind of call out like different things that are happening at the same time, because it's orchestrating multiple tasks.
Yeah.
And so after it runs, so it deployed a couple services, so deployments into Kubernetes. Then it deployed a pod with a test driver, and then it ran that and it extracted the logs and said my test passed because the pod returned with a exit code 0. Yep. So that's kind of the test system that we used. And we had many of these tests internally. And every time we were targeting either a local Kubernetes or a remote Kubernetes, it would just take a long time to bring up the Kubernetes cluster remotely. So that was kind of the first thing that we did. So rather than run it locally, we can say, well, I want to run the tests on Namespace. And also, I don't want to build locally, I want to build remotely. And when I now run, and without specifying which is the test, it will do that over all the tests that exist. So now the output that you see here is actually coming from the remote builder that is building these binaries. You see, exporting to OCI, publishing to nscr.io. So it's kind of the same thing, but it's deploying kind of remotely. But in this mode, it's still going one by one. So it was still a little bit too slow. So what we did instead was, well, we want it to go really fast. So I'm just going to stop that.
Yeah, I saw there you had 40 something actions running and 140 waiting to run.
Exactly. And part of that is we were actually trying to manage how much resources we were using. So we added this, we have a parallel feature that runs everything in parallel, but even that does some internal throttling. So we have a hidden flag, which I cannot reveal because it doesn't matter, which is rocket ship, which is kind of disables all internal throttling. So now it's building everything in parallel. It's,
wow, look at that waiting. Wow, look how it's going down. 33, it was like 100 and something when we started.
Yes.
Okay. How many machines are you spinning, by the way?
So it should be 1, 2, 3. It should be just 8. Mm-hmm. So it's actually just, not.
Yeah. Yeah, how big is each?
So we can actually check out. Let me pull that up. So actually just 6. Just 6 4x8 that were created. And you can see they were just created right now.
Yeah.
One for each test. And if we go there, we see like CPU usage, memory, everything. We also see all of the containers that are started as part of this test. Typically, you are able to go and check the logs of a particular container. And that was kind of the origin of Namespace. It was to run these tests really quickly. We can see here they're already finished. So it took 33, 39. This one took a little bit longer, but all of the weighted. So this weighted time is mostly to create an instance and get to a working Kubernetes API server.
Yeah.
So there's a bit of a distribution. So this one took a little bit longer, but that's kind of the total time. So it was this that motivated the creation of Namespace. And that's why we're so container centric. That's why you get kind of data, because we wanted to understand how long it took to kind of start things, how much resources were being used to size things. And even yourself, you can go and check how long it takes to create a particular instance. So in this case, the request came in, then it got started 840 milliseconds later. So that's kind of our internal scheduling. And then it was ready. So that means that it's already running user code 1,052 milliseconds later. So 1.9 seconds in total that it took for this particular instance to start.
If you're counting in milliseconds, that sounds right. What you're saying, I don't care about the rest. You said milliseconds, that's okay. So I'm curious, if you were to do time and then if you were to do bang, bang, what happens? That's it. Run that. It runs the same command, the last command. That's what the bang bang gets replaced with. But you put the time in front of it. So now we will see the total execution, you know, how we were counting before. So if we run this, I'm assuming, is there caching? Do you use caching?
So this case, we'll see caching for build. So the build was much faster.
Yeah.
But all the tests, they're being deployed from scratch. So there's always a new Kubernetes cluster created from scratch. All of the deployments were created from scratch. Everything is being created from scratch. The UI is a little bit different because of the parallelism. We don't show the individual deployments, but you can see here kind of deploy, wait until ready. So kind of it's been a deployment and is waiting for that particular server that it deployed to become ready before being able to advance.
How many Kubernetes clusters do you spin? Do you spin one or one per test? How does that work?
It's one per test. And we can see, so if we go instances, each of these, so these are the current runs, some of them already finished for what we're just doing. Each one of them is a Kubernetes cluster.
Interesting. Okay. What Kubernetes distribution are you using?
So we're using a K3S. Customized, but the baseline is K3S for this mode.
Got it. And that's our answer right there.
Yeah. So if you do NSC create, which is kind of creating an instance from scratch, and you see waiting for Kubernetes, this created something from scratch. We can go NSCSSH. Oops, sorry. NSCSSH. We go in.
Yeah.
We can check the uptime. It was just created, so there's no kind of pre-warming or anything.
Yeah.
And, well, obviously there's nothing here, but it's just we still have the MetaLLB, because we use MetaLLB to handle some of the ingress bits when Kubernetes is used. So that's still becoming ready. So that's one of those examples of software that is just not set up to start very quickly. But the Kubernetes API server and like Core DNS, et cetera, they start, everything starts extremely quickly.
Okay. If you do a get node and then dash o wide, what do we get?
Get one node.
Wide, yeah. Okay.
That Wolfie. Is this particular.
Very interesting. Operating system image. That's what I was looking at. Version, the Kubernetes version. Kernel 6.7. That's a very new one. And Container-D 1.7. Yes. Very nice. Very nice. Yeah.
Okay. So all of these, so this is our guest image where we're in. It's Wolfie based. Kernel version, that's one thing that you need to use the kernel that we get you. And we try to be as close to upstream as possible. There's kernel configuration that is important for us that we do. And that's why we kind of control the kernel. Containerd we also deploy because... And when we're using K3S, it's actually using the Containerd that we manage.
Interesting.
Same thing with Docker PS. So if you do, so if we go to kates.io and we list, you see that this is, so this is kind of the same Containerd that we set up. And the reason for that is there's some features that are enabled because we manage Containerd for you. So if I wanted to go and do run, let's say Nginx, and we detach, and then we list Mobi, we see here, so this would be Nginx. So there
we go. Got it. Nice. Okay. Do you still use like this setup today, like for foundation? Is this like actively deployed, actively used, available on GitHub for others to see how this gets wired together?
Yes, foundation is open source. And this is how it's the framework that we use to build Namespace. And there's still some tests and a few things that help you understand a little bit better, because a lot of the in order to fully understand how it works, you do need to have like services and servers and everything to kind of get a full understanding, and that is private. But the whole framework is open source, and that was always our intention. Foundation is designed a lot around things that we've built in our previous lives that have been kind of useful for us to build applications.
Nice. Cool. Now, I have something that I hope you'll be able to help me with.
Yep.
And for that, I'll need to start screen sharing.